at the Mount, what us Northerners would call Ruhama Baptist Church, but I understand that down here it's Rama Baptist Church in Catawba County, North Carolina. 8:35 a.m., July 14th, 2001. This is the site and gathering place of the first annual Ultimate Summitt with One or Two T's family reunion. There's a large cemetery behind the church. We'll go photograph that later. Right now, we'll go in and meet a few people. Few minutes, sir. Can you tell us about yourself?
I'm Paul M.
M for Moody.
M for Moody.
The famous publisher of the Summitt Family
infamous.
Quarterly.
Infamous, I would say.
And you come from?
Columbia, Missouri.
Descended from?
Let's see. Chester Moody, Chester Albee, James Lee, Jonathan, Daniel, Johann Franz.
Thank you. And
I'm Sam Clark. I'm from Pennsylvania, Adams County.
Who's your grandma and grandpa in there today?
Mr. and Mrs. Beasley.
And do you know how they tie into the Summitt line?
Not really.
I guess we'll find out, won't we? Thank you. Tell us about yourselves. Where are you from?
We didn't care about them. We live here.
And you tie into the Summitt's house. Where do you tie into the Summitts?
What?
It's got
of Isaac's? Where is it? What
grade? This is from
I lived out in Florida. Now I was born in Arkansas. Lived most of my life in Washington, D.C. here.
Culture that Paul C has put together.
It's the Panhandle. It's about 40 miles east.
Here is mine, and this is right here.
Okay, how do you folks tie into the Summitt line? Tell me all about it.
You tell them.
Don't be shy, this is for posterity. Introduce yourselves first.
My name is Geraldine Elizabeth Schoonover.
And I'm Carl Schoonover.
And my maiden name is Elaine. Sarah Summitt was my grandfather's. My grandfather's name was Aaron Nail, and Sarah Summitt married Henry Nail.
Uh-huh.
My mother's father, which is John Abeck Palmer, his mother was Naomi Elizabeth Summitt, and she married Joseph Palmer.
Okay.
And my mother's mother was Essie Moore. She married my grandfather, John Lovett Caldwell, and her grandmother was either Margaret.
So you're tied into the Summitt's three different directions.
Three times.
All right, excellent. Thank you so much.
Actually, only two lines, but actually it came through.
Okay, excellent.
And I'm proud to be in the lineage of the Summitts.
Glad to have you here today.
And meet and be family. This is not the some of the typical ones that cover dish dinners. Many other people have come long distances. Ohio, Missouri, Arkansas, Florida, Maryland, Massachusetts, Indiana.
Indiana.
So, for those who live down the road a piece, this is very important to these people. We got started on this last year, and as you Perhaps no, we had originally planned to meet at St. John's Lutheran Church because that was where Francis Summitt is buried. Well, you know what happened to St. John's? It burned, so we had to relocate, and graciously, Mount Rahama received us. Very gracious. The first part of the program, Glenn Summitt is going to speak on, Marilyn Summitt is supposed to speak on the Family Album and Heritage Project that we've come up with. Now, do you want to do that or wait? Okay, we'll get Glenn up here first then. Glenn is going to speak on the Summitt Summit. Now, Summitt was, is that the original spelling?
S-A-M-M-E-T.
It is the original name. Last night I received a call from a Jerry Summitt. Where is he?
Right here.
Oh, there he is. It lives in Mooresville. Asking about the reunion, he had received some information from his parents, right?
Yes, uh-huh.
Who live in Ohio. And he wanted to come. So the Summitt name is Summitt, Salmon. Do what you want with it. many variations. Glenn is going to speak to you on the origins, the colonial presence, and the migration, and what families went where. And Glenn has done a super job in researching the Summitt name. And in fact, Glenn, didn't you say there was a Summitt or Summitt on a Spanish ship?
Well, there's a John Summitt on the eastern side of North Carolina that was involved with searching for a ship, the Spanish at the time.
Oh, I thought you said it was a crew on an old Spanish ship.
No. Oh, okay. But he's a big mystery. I'm not sure quite how he ties in it.
Okay.
But
are you ready?
Yeah, I think I am.
Okay. Glenn Summitt is the son of Charles Eli Summitt Jr., who is the son of Charles Eli Summitt, who is the son of Alexander Commodore and Laura Dora Bollinger Summitt. They are buried out here in the cemetery. In fact, all of Purley's children are buried here, for those who don't belong here.
Great to be here to speak. To meet so many Summitts and people who have married into the family. And, from what I've heard, there are people from Florida. Paul Clayton Summitt is here somewhere, and he's been researching the Summitt family for about 30 years. And also, I was told that Ashley Summitt was going to be here. She's actually from the Lincolnville area. And what's kind of neat about it is she went to school in Boston, where I'm from, and we sort of connected that way. So it's good to meet all these people that we've connected through the internet over the years today. I think Dan Summitt's supposed to be here today from Lexington, who we haven't really talked to lately, but he's a big researcher. Then John Allen is from Indiana, and he did this wonderful family tree. I don't know if everyone has seen it yet, but that's quite a thing. And of course, Marilyn K. Summitt is at the table up front here doing registration from Florida. But anyway, the Summitts with this church have a long history. And my grandfather, Charles Summitt, was actually born on Oliver's Crossing, which is, I guess, just on the back side of this church. And he was born in the same house as Paulina Summitt. And I'm not sure if you all know that much about Paulina, but she was the wife of Isaac Summitt, who was mortally wounded at the Battle of Green Station in Culpeper County, Virginia. And Isaac's father actually owned all of this land as well. And according to the deed, this church was originated at Killian's Meeting House, and John bought this land from David Killian. So you can see the Summitts in this immediate area have a long and intertwined history with the Summitt family, and it's great. I mean, it's unfortunate that St. John burned down, but from my perspective and the branch of the family I come from, it's great that we're able to be here today. But I'm going to speak today about the very first origins of the Summitts in America. And some of you might be surprised to know that the very genesis of the Summitts was 250 years ago. On September 5th, 1753, the ship Beulah actually came to the port of Philadelphia on a Monday afternoon, and it was on that day that Jacob Summitt actually first stepped foot on colonial soil, and he spelled his name S-A-M-M-E-T. So, and of course I just learned that we have a Summitt here with us, so we have some living evidence that we've got some real connections going. But his trip can be broken up into three parts. We suspect, according to LDS records and records on the internet, that most Summitts originated from the Württemberg area of Germany, which is in the southeast area of Germany in the Palatinate. And we assume that he probably took a boat, a ship down the River Rhine, which goes through Germany. And at that time, there were 27 custom houses, and the clerks would typically take their time, so it could have easily taken Jacob about 2 or 3 months just to get down that specific river. So you can see it wasn't like today, where you could just get on a jet and fly across the Atlantic. The second part is when, once he got through the Rhine, he actually went to Rotterdam. And then from there, he went to southeast England, to Cowes, which is on the island of Wight, and probably the ship brought on a lot of supplies, maybe even got more passengers. And from there, the third part of his journey, which was the most dangerous part, was to cross the Atlantic. And many times, typhoid, scurvy, lack of food would cause a lot of death. And many times during these journeys, they actually saw their own family members get thrown out of the ship. So you should assume that actually this was a pretty dangerous journey to come from Germany, and actually took up to 6 months to happen. So after he arrived at Philadelphia, what's interesting is that Summitts began to pop up all over southeastern Pennsylvania. We see Christian Summitt, or Summitt, I think the proper pronunciation, even though it's spelled S-A-M-M-E-T, is Summitt, which is where we get our name. Christian Summitt actually married Maria Stalhern in 1755 in Philadelphia. So he's the very next Summitt that we see after Jacob arrives in Philadelphia. From there, we start to see different Summitts. Specifically, only six. I actually visited Berks County last summer and went through 5 or 6 different libraries and universities, and I could only find, of course, Jacob, who came in on the Beulah, and then Christian, a Susanna Summitt, a Maria Summitt, a Rosina Summitt, and then there is a Francis Summitt, spelled S-O-M-E-T-T, and he's in Douglas Township. In Berks County, Pennsylvania. I'll talk about him later because he probably has a deeper connection, at least to the North Carolina Summitts and those who went to Tennessee and Indiana. We also find Christian on a 1757 tax list in Ole Township, as well as Reading, Pennsylvania. And then Jacob is in Ruscomb Manor in 1760. So is in Christian in 1760. And then 1764, Christian is, I guess he moved to Maiden Creek, which is kind of interesting because there's a Maiden Creek that goes right around his church. I don't know if there's a connection, but it's probably just coincidence. It's kind of neat to just wonder about that stuff. And then in 1767, Jacob is in Ruscomb Manor still, and he's listed as married. And but what's interesting is the next time we have a record in Berks County, Pennsylvania, 1769. And that is when Jacob, Rosina Summitt gets married to John Swank. And she actually lists Jacob as her father. So this is the first evidence that this Jacob is actually the father to any of these individuals. So you can sort of see where the family tree is starting to take hold. But what's interesting is, in 1769, after that point, we don't see any more Summitts in Berks County, Pennsylvania. And I guess that begs the question, where did they all go? Well, basically, to make it simple, they all went to Virginia. However, today, if we look at what sections of Virginia they went to, it could be anywhere from western Pennsylvania to West Virginia to current Kentucky. That is basically where we start to see the same family show up again. And at the time that they left, it would have been in the 1770s. We actually see Christian Summitt showing up in western Pennsylvania in a lawsuit from August 1777 to August 1778, but he decided to drop that case against anyone, the person that he was in the lawsuit with. Let's see, what else? In 1778, Jacob Summitt, and I suspect this is the exact same Summitt who came over on the ship Beulah, he actually received a land grant from Lord Fairfax in what was then Hampshire County, Virginia. And what's interesting about this area of Hampshire County, Virginia, is that George Washington actually, when he was 16 years old, he actually went to Hampshire County, Virginia, and actually was surveying that whole area where Jacob would later end up living. In 1780, Rosanna is living with John Swank in Hardin County, Kentucky, or Virginia, which later becomes Kentucky. So you can see that it's pretty solid that this is the exact same family, because these same names just start showing up in Virginia right after all the Summitts disappeared in Berks County, Pennsylvania. And then in 1783, Christian Summitt and his son George Summitt can be found in Bourbon County, Virginia, which later becomes Nicholas County, Kentucky. And they have a very interesting story, because the Christian's great-great-granddaughter actually wrote a book. I don't know if any of you have read it, but she wrote a really interesting story about what she had been told about George Summitt, and how in 1783 George Summitt came down with a party from Pennsylvania down the Ohio River, and then they got off, I believe, at the Blue Lick or something like that, and then took a buffalo trail to that part of Kentucky where they actually settled. And what's kind of interesting about them is, at that period, that part of Kentucky or Virginia was very much a frontier part of colonial America. I mean, it was a very dangerous place. There's a lot of friction going on between the Native Americans and the colonists. And at that time, a lot of people lived in stations, which would be what we would think of as a fort. And George actually lived in Grant Station for a while, and then he went to another station and planted some corn. But then later on in 1783, he actually built what became Summitt Station. And you can still go to that area today in Kentucky. I believe it's in Nicholas County, is that right, Paul? And in that area, you can still visit the Summitt Snap Cemetery, where most of these people lived. And Summitt's lived right on Summitt Station for generations, including Emma Rankin, who actually wrote this book. I wish I had brought a copy of it.
This area is just west.
Interesting. After George and Christian are in that part of Kentucky, in 1784 we find Susanna Summitt. She marries John Wyatt. And then in 1785, John Summitt marries Margaret Snap in Lincoln County, Virginia, which later becomes Kentucky. 1789, George Summitt, he marries Rosanna Graham in Bourbon County, Virginia, which later becomes Kentucky. And right around that time, Christian deeds, I believe, about two-thirds of Summitt Station to his son, George. And I know for a fact that in the tax records, Christian and George are right there together, and then we think Christian dies and George is just paying the taxes in that period. Let's see. And all also during this period, during the American Revolution, John Summitt, who married Margaret Snap, was involved, and he's listed as a patriot. I've also found a Patrick Summitt in Virginia. Don't know where he fits in. I found a Richard Summitt who fought in the Revolution. And then George Summitt is listed, and I believe that he's the same George that's at Summitt Station. But interestingly enough, I've also found Summitts on the other side, fighting on the other. They were listed as loyalists during the American Revolution. But they're in South Carolina, and I'm not quite sure. You know, I think there's a connection somewhere, but it's really hard to say, you know, if they were actually part of this core unit from Berks County, Pennsylvania. And I guess that kind of leaves you wondering if you're from North Carolina or descended from Francis Summitt, who's buried over here at St. John's Lutheran, how do you fit into all these Kentucky Summitts? Well, I think I mentioned earlier that on one of the tax lists, there was a Francis Summitt listed in 1784, I believe, or 1774, I can't remember exactly. I suspect that it's possible that this is the same Francis Summitt that is in North Carolina in 1789, possibly even 1769. We don't have any proof, but I have a suspicion that this Francis Summitt, if they were the same person, he probably went to Western Pennsylvania with his brother Christian, and then there was the old wagon road that I've been reading about on the Catawba County GenWeb site, and he probably came right down through the Blue Ridge Mountains, and that wagon road actually goes right through Catawba County, from what I've been told. So it seems likely that this is probably the same Francis Summitt. And if you're a North Carolina Summitt, if you're from Indiana, you probably descend from Francis's son, Christian, who went to Indiana. If you're from Tennessee or Missouri, you probably descend from Francis's son, Daniel. And if you're living in North Carolina or descended from the North Carolina Summitts, you're probably from Jacob. And he married Polly Cloninger in 1805. I don't want to go on anymore about the North Carolina Summitts because our good friend from Florida, Paul, is going to do a good job at telling us about that branch of the family and how we're probably all connected. But one other thing I wanted to say about the Summitts is, even in the 19th century, Summitts came over from Germany and did the exact same thing that Jacob Summitt did from the ship Beulah. Suddenly his name was spelled S-U-M-M-I-T. And in fact, on the ship's manifest, Jacob spells his name with one T, and then on the second manifest, it lists his name with two T's. So I'm sure a lot of you are wondering why some of us are single T Summitts and some of us are double T Summitts. And even back then, they were confused. So, but anyway, thank you for listening. And I just want to let Bob continue on with
1500. Any much more than that, I would have had to build a bigger church, I think, to put it on the wall. So, you'll notice when you look at it, it starts up there at the top with Francis. And then goes down to Francis's children, and so you'll have to follow that down. You'll follow a single line, and then when you get to a box that has a double line connected to it, double lines are marriages. So you'll see a box with Christian Summitt in it, for example, and then you'll see a double line that'll go over to his wife. If he was married more than once, you'll see other double lines coming off of his box, double wide lines, which indicate marriages. And then off of that box, you'll see a single line come down, then that indicate their children. So if you just kind of look real close, you can see where the boxes will connect with the line, and then a double line for the marriage, and then a line off of that then for their children. So you'll at least know how to read this banner here. Okay. You probably have some questions. I'll be out there to kind of answer some questions. That's a lot of information on the wall there. Somebody, you should be able to go back and at least find your grandfather off of that sheet. take this opportunity to thank Bob Schuling and all his hard work in putting this together here. Most of us have been communicating, I know, with Paul C. there for 5-6 years online. Paul Moody was one of the original ones. Paul C. and Paul Moody kind of got everybody else. I will not say Paul C. cajoled everybody, but he kind of gave everybody a shove, you know, all right, let's get some more information on your family. So that's where we most of us started. And then Marilyn came on board. She's behind the wall over there. And then Glenn came on board. And it's a lot of hours, a lot of research. Paul's flown all over the country doing research. He's been to Indiana. My line comes from Indiana, by the way. And we get some time later on, maybe we'll cover the Indiana summits. There were several of Francis's children that came to Indiana. So anyway, I wanted to explain how to look at this banner, so I'll be out there if you have any questions. Okay. Thank you.
John, want to need a pen around and get photos of people that are here? Fine folks that are showing up today. Finding out who everybody is, slowly but surely.
Can I have everyone's attention, please? Has everyone been down the banner? Has everyone viewed the banner?
Give us something she'd written in her family history to put in our book with a picture. And as Paul and I noted, the problem was she didn't always write the names of who was in the pictures on the back. However, they also had a Super 8 movie camera, which if any of you have taken old movies, you would know a Super 8, which you now have to get transposed onto those. So each one of us in our branch had a distinct family tree written going back about five generations. I only knew these five generations until about 4 years ago when this guy named Paul C. Summitt in Freeport and John Allen in Indianapolis connected my branch in. And so along with the ones I have on my banner, I also have two generations below me. I have two grandchildren. Each of them now have their own books. So what I want to encourage each one of you is to go to your books. This is what I did. I went to each aunt and uncle on every vacation as a teenager, in my 20s, in my 30s, in my 40s. I went to each one of them. I copied down everything in their family trees and their Bibles. I got them to give me their private diaries so I could take photocopies. And it may not seem like much to any of you right now, but what my grandmother did is extremely valuable to each of us now. And everybody wants what I've been collecting from her. She was dead over 10 years before anybody found these photo albums, which told secrets that we didn't know. We didn't know when they were really married. We didn't know some of the distinguished relatives. The reason we didn't know is they were in the country. The children were all born at home. They put on the birth certificate, whatever they could remember about the date and the time. And I'm sure many of you have a lot of these. Even my father's birth certificate, he was born at home in the woods, approximately, you will love this, first child, 13 pounds. he was the first child. I'm a short one. He's like 6'2 and a half. But all of them are very large children. So I'm going to leave these two albums out for a while because many of you may recognize some of these people who I don't recognize. And you're welcome to take scanned copies of all of these in here, but I want a show of hands. How many of you have ever given a small photo collection to a descendant? Anybody?
Does it count if you're working on it?
If you're working on it. Yeah. If you're working on it, Paul, I know you probably have. Okay. Now, I bet not one of you have a single excuse why you haven't done that. Not one. If you are that interested in your family tree, then you should be giving this to your children. You should be giving it to your grandchildren. Two of my daughters are already married, and one of their wedding presents was a photo album that started with, there's a page or two to each family grouping and to each generation, and on the right side is something written on it, who they are and when it was taken, whether it was in San Francisco or whether it was in Europe, because they're not going to remember it today, their 20s. It doesn't seem that important to them. But as they hit the 30s and the 40s, they start saying, well, I don't even remember my great-grandmother. And many of you can say the same thing. You don't remember. How many of you have been given a photo album from your grandparents? You're letting your lines die in memory. If I can't instill anything else in any of you, is when you leave this place and you go home, buy a small photo album, every single one of your descendants, I don't care if you've got 14 grandkids and 25 great-grandkids, every single one of them, go through your photo albums, get the copies made, make one for each one of them. Take the time. You've got 5.5 months to Christmas. That can be a Christmas gift that will last forever. I mean forever. That's some of the things that most of my nieces and nephews now look to me to get, because their parents didn't do that. I've got my distant cousins from several branches over. They're all looking to me for my grandparents because they know that I spent 25 years going to funerals and going and getting the photo albums, going and collecting them. Look in the attics, look in your garages. These were found stuck in an old cardboard box in Tucson, Arizona about 5 years ago. And they've been there for 10 years. So I'm going to leave these out to take photos, but anybody have any questions on how to present these or what you might be putting in them? Little stuff counts. Little stuff like Johnny took his first step. Now I know you've got Trey. Okay, Trey turned a year old on June 28th. The only reason I know that is I'm paying attention to the dates for the name tags, and my youngest grandson was born 5 days later. Right? Trey doesn't care about these photo albums right now. But if his mom starts right now and adds a picture every year, gives a small, even if you just send them a note telling them it's important to you that you keep this with the book I gave you last year. Next year I'm going to give you a few more pages to add to it. Next year I'm going to give you a few more pages to add to that. By the time they are 40, they are going to have a collection that's irreplaceable. And what if you're not here to help supplement it? You've also instilled that in them. Many of you don't know me yet, but if I get your names, I'll be bugging you. I can tell you, Paul will warn you that I will get on the internet. John Allen, you know, I'll bug you and welcome each one of you. So. And if you have more than one line, be sure and document that. I had an unusual occurrence in my family, which I've found with some others here, is that I can trace back more than one way because I have sisters that married cousins, so my mother's family, my father's family. You know, I've got cousins that are aunt, uncles. I really actually do. So, you know, so far I'm not related to my grandchildren other than being by their grandchildren, but they're going to have these trees that they can track now. Take the family Bibles that your grandmothers had when we used to have large table Bibles. We still have ours and the letters cracked and hard. Take it to a good library that you can get a good color photograph of what was handwritten in the family tree. Make those, frame them, or whatever, but make them the cover page of their family tree book that you're making for them. Every year, add to it. But I encourage you to do that. And each time a new child is born, make sure that you add a picture. Get a picture of a new child, a new grandson, a new niece, your new nephew. Get it developed and add that to that year's Christmas book, Christmas gift. It solves your Christmas gifts, it solves your lineage, and you've added all the new ones and written one more memory for them. So, any questions? Anybody, I haven't got a name tag to, I apologize, I'm working as fast as I can back there. So.
I do like to keep things straight. Sorry I needed to correct him on where I live. But I like to tell people I still live in old Lincoln County and walk by Clark's Creek, and the water still runs there just like it did when John Clark first found it and gave it his name. I will tell you a little bit of background about me, about why I'm here and what I'm here about. In 1996, I got a computer, and the first thing I found was I walked in the courthouse at Newton and was, don't even know why I was there, but it wasn't genealogy, but I met a man who had come to Newton the day before for the Coulter reunion. Well, come to find out, the Coulters and the Plunks had gotten together along back years ago, and so he said, well, I've got a book almost ready to print. And I found out I needed to put all the update stuff in it that he had to old people back in 1750, but I had the other part. And I printed a Plunk book and a Coulter book by the time I got my computer started and went from there. But I have learned to love because of a son who started in 1975. He had to do a little work in school on his ancestors and came home one Sunday and said, Dad, did you know that you and mother descend from brothers? What? You descend from brother. I said, what about mom and daddy? Didn't we get related to them too? Oh yes, I guess we did, didn't we? So that's where it started, and my interest has grown, and I love to play with my computer and the internet, and it's getting better every day. I can do more sitting at home than I could have 10 years ago by traveling all over the area. But thank goodness I was brought up rabbit hunting in old Lincoln County, and I know where the old houses are You can't find them because it's nothing but a pile of rock where the logs rotted, and where the I know where the springs are because they're still there. I know where the creeks are, they're still there. But I kind of changed my subject a little bit because people have been needling me, wanting to know what I was going to say today and what I was going to do. And I promised them I'd put it on the internet. So you don't have to take notes if you want everything I've got. It will be published on the internet, on Catawba West, probably on Lincoln County and Gaston County and Cleveland County and Burke County and also on Rufford County, most likely. But I will put it on with a bibliography of the books that I read and where I found the information that's here. And I will read it for that purpose because I don't want to say things and then get somewhere else, but in the answers and the questions, why we'll go wherever you would like. And I have gone with the history of North Carolina, and that's where we'll start. 1492, October the 12th, Columbus discovers America. 1705, we're going to jump fast, so I hope you got your horses saddled and you're ready to ramble, because we're gonna move on. And this was the only way I could organize it, was by using dates. So forget about what's in between. That was nothing happened that was important. 1705, the first church in North Carolina was built in Shawan County. Lord Granville instructed Sir Nathaniel Moore to establish the religion of the Church of England in the colony by legal authority. This is important. You know why? This is the reason that we had schoolhouses in old Lincoln County in this area. When the people moved in shortly after 1750, they started schoolhouses because they could have a meeting there and have a religious service there, but land could not be given to any church unless it was the Episcopal Church, the Church of England. So that was an important thing. In 1729, on the 3rd of August, Richard Caswell was born in Maryland. I'll let you know more about who Richard Caswell was if you don't know. You should know him. 1745. This is news to a lot of people. St. John's Lutheran Church was founded in Craven County. Now, this St. John's Lutheran Church was first known as the Dutch Buffalo Creek Church. The congregation itself gives 1745 as the year of its organized beginning. I've searched for old maps, and I can find at this time there was Craven County. This was before the King of England gave North Carolina to Governors Granville and Tryon. When they were given the state, a line was run through the center of the state, and the northern part was called Granville District, and the southern part was the Tryon District. Therefore, in 1745, Craven County was the only county before St. John's was founded on Dutch Buffalo Creek. Craven County, North Carolina, because Carolina had been divided in North and South Carolina, you must remember that St. John's Lutheran Church has always been at the same place. Just the name of the area has been changed. So St. John's has been in Craven County, Granville County, Bladen County, Anson County, Mecklenburg County, and finally it is in Cabarrus County and hasn't moved an inch. But you have to go back to the date when you make a statement where it's located for the name of the county. You have to know when it was.
The impression of the plunderers in around 11 or
12. Oh yeah, they were Newton southward in Lincoln County, mostly Lincoln County. Like Pat said, the parks, the homelessness, the Russos. Russos are spread out, but those other families were pretty well concentrated together. Daniels, Lutheran Church, Salem. People were identified back then by the church that they attended.
What about the Abernathys? Where did they...
Abernathys were an English family that came from Virginia, came through Virginia, probably settled in the early English colonies in eastern Virginia, but they came down and settled in first in the same areas that the Sherrills and the Scotch-Irish settled, which was in the southeast corner of the county, down in Terrell. Charles Ford, Mountain Creek.
As far as we can, it's not as far as we can tell. We know that this original Francis Summitt settled on land on the waters of Leapers Creek.
Yeah, that's Swift County. That's eastern Lincoln.
And they at least did the deed work on that in 1789.
Here's an interesting thing. From 1777 to 1779, you'll find all the records of Burke County in a 2-year period. Lincoln County was formed in 1789, and that's when Burke County lost its portion. So I did the land grants.
You mean the Catawba County part of it?
Yeah. On the Burke County website, I've got the Burke County land grants, and for 2 years there, those in 1777 through 79, you see an awful lot of familiar Catawba County names, because they were in Catawba County.
Well, as best we could tell, Francis and his family, of course, about him, the number of the children were grown up, I mean, like in their 20s and whatnot. But he moved up to Lyles Creek around 1802.
That's what they call Lyles Creek. It covers more than Lyles Creek. Lyles Creek covers all the way from St. John's south into Cobb. And Lyles Creek today is 3 miles west of Connell. Where is the Lyles Creek?
I don't know whether Glenn has ever tried to successfully pin down where the land is.
Lyles Creek has been pretty well plotted by James Miller, and the map of the Lyles Creek neighborhood, which they call it the Lyles Creek neighborhood, even though it extends well beyond the boundaries of the creek, the floodplain of the creek, it's on the wall at Catawba County Library. James Miller was one of the founders of the Little Genealogical Society.
Is that on the website?
No. Some of James Miller's work is on the website as far as the formation of Catawba County.
Well, I'd be curious if, does it date back to the turn of the century, around 1800?
Yeah.
It'd be interesting to find out whether any of the land around there is attributed to Summitt and Francis, because he of course owned it all the way up until his death in 1818, and then four of his sons ended up with it. But we have the deed, so we know who owned it before him.
Blocking traffic, so. That's a pretty...
It's hard to read.
What,
Yeah, it's almost impossible to read, I think.
you can make it, Teppong, T-E-P-P-O-N-G.
Uh-huh.
And from that, they spelled it tip. But they weren't long from here. That's another tip dog. Uh-huh. Lewis is, where the heck is Lewis?
T-E-P.
Just about.
Lewis Hewitt, born September, you make the rest of that out? A.D. 1767.
Looks like September 1.
Died August the 31st, 1835, age 68 years. And this should be Margaret.
That is Margaret. You know, if you're going to get that, you're going to have to use shaving cream or something.
Yep. Yeah.
You know what? It's a good thing if you've got available sun, is get a sheet of cardboard and staple aluminum foil to it, and you can aim it just the way you want.